In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. By the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and the Immaculate Heart of Mary, one with Louisa, the little daughter of the divine will, I enter into the holy divine will. Come, divine will, come beat in my every heartbeat, come breathe in my every breath, come pray, adore, and reign in me. In the name of everyone and everything, past, present, and future, in, with, through, and for Jesus, Mary, and Louisa, in, with, and for all, that all may be for the glory of God and the good of all souls, giving to God as if all lived in the most holy divine will. United with creation, redemption, and sanctification, praying as one in that one eternal act. For the kingdom to come, reign on earth. Fiat.
Do not stop, otherwise we will not find you always together with us in our moans and in our secret tears. We will feel the void of your requital love. Descend into the sacrament of ordination. Here, yes, you will find our most intimate hidden sorrow, the most bitter tears, the most harrowing sounds. The ordination constitutes a man to a supreme height, to a divine character, to a repeater of my life, the administer of the sacraments, the revealer of my secrets, of my gospels, of my most holy sacred science, and the peacemaker between heaven and earth, the bearer of Jesus to souls. So here we see how the Lord has given to the priesthood, as he says, the most supreme height and a divine character, the repeater of the life of Jesus, the administer of the sacraments, the revealer of the divine character, the repeater of Jesus' life. The priesthood is the most important sacrament because it institutes or gives the other sacraments their life. So Jesus shows us that the priesthood is where he has his greatest sorrow. He says, but alas, how many times we see in the ordained one how he will be a Judas for us, a usurper of the character which is being impressed in him. Oh, how the Holy Spirit moans and seeing in the ordained one, in the most sacred things, the greatest character that exists between heaven and earth being snatched away from him. See, this is why we pray for priests every day. We pray for the bishops and the priests. We pray for the Holy Father every day. The devil knows if he can destroy the priesthood, he can basically get rid of the most sacred things, the greatest character. And our job is to pray. If we have a few priests, Jesus tells us it's because we're not praying for priests. If the churches are closing, Jesus says that he is closing them. And it could be because we have no more priests. So there are vocations. The vocations are out there. And what we need to do is to pray with confidence and trust in each family for priests, for the priesthood. Jesus says, how many profanations? Each act of this ordained one, not done in according to the character impressed, will be a cry of sorrow, a bitter crying, a harrowing moan. The ordination is the sacrament which encloses all the other sacraments together. Therefore, if the ordained one is able to persevere whole within himself the character he has received, he will almost place all the other sacraments in safety. He will be the defender and the savior of Jesus himself. But not seeing this in the ordained one, our sorrows are sharpened more, our moans become more continuous and sorrowful. Therefore, let your requital of love flow in each priestly act to keep company with the moaning love of the Holy Spirit. This is where we do our rounds in redemption, you know, in the name of Jesus, the High Priest. Lend us the ear of your heart and listen to our profound moans in the sacrament of marriage. How many disorders in it! Marriage was elevated by me to a sacrament in order to place in it a sacred bond, a symbol of the sacrosanct Trinity, the divine love which it encloses. So the love which was to reign in the Father, the Mother, and children, the concord and peace, was to symbolize the celestial family. I was to have on earth as many other families similar to the family of the Creator, destined to populate the earth like as many terrestrial angels, to then bring them back to populate the celestial regions. But how many moans and seeing families of sin being formed in marriage, which symbolizes hell, with discord, with lack of love, with hatred, which populate the earth like many rebellious angels who will serve to populate hell. The Holy Spirit moans with harrowing moans in each marriage, and in seeing so many infernal dens being formed on earth, therefore place your requital of love in each marriage, in each creature which comes to the light. In this way, your loving moan will rend less sorrowful our continuous moans. So here Jesus is showing us that he's called marriage to a high sanctity. And it seems like, what, half of the marriages, 50% of the marriages are being ended up in divorce. The Lord wants and pleads with us to pray so that these families become really a symbol of the celestial family in heaven. Our moans are not yet finished. Therefore, let your requital of love reach the bed of the dying one. When the sacrament of the extreme unction is administered. But how many dying ones, how many moans, how many of our secret tears. The sacrament has the virtue of placing the dying sinner in safety at any cost. It is the confirmation of sanctity for the good and the holy. It is the last bond which is established through its unction between the creature and God. It is the seal of heaven which is impressed and redeemed in the redeemed soul. It is the infusion of the merits of the Redeemer in order to enrich the soul, purify the soul, embellish the soul. It is the final brushstroke which the Holy Spirit gives to the soul in order to dispose her to depart from earth, as so as to make her appear before the Creator. In sum, the extreme unction is the final display of our love, the final clothing of the soul. It is the rearranging of all the good works, and therefore it acts in a surprising way in those who are alive to grace. With the extreme unction, the soul has, though covered by a celestial dew, which extinguishes as though in one breath all her passions, her attachments to the earth, and all that does not belong to heaven. So we see how important it is for the priest to bring this sacrament of the sick to those that are dying, how it gives them the final ticket to enter into heaven. But how many people do not understand this? Many people die without this last rites, this extreme unction, this prayer, this final sacrament. And so Jesus says, "Well, if all could hear our moans, our crying over the bed, but alas, how many moans, how many bitter tears, and how many dispositions, how many negligences, how many losses of souls, how few the sanctities in it find to be confirmed, how scarce the good works to be reordered and rearranged. Oh, if all could hear the moans of our crying over the bed of the dying ones in the act of administering the sacrament of extreme unction, all would cry with sorrow. Do you not want, then, to give us your requital of love for each time the sacrament is administered? which is the final display of our love toward the creature. Our will awaits you, you everywhere. You have your requital of love, your company with our moans and our sighs. So here Jesus is showing us through the holy sacraments that we can repair and redo in the name of everyone and everything past, present, and future by praying in union with Jesus, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in these sacraments so that we can repair and redo everything as if they were received and given in the proper manner, the proper way. Again, our job in the divine will is different from others, the saints before us. Our job is to really begin to live a life that is repair, to live a life that is glory and honor for our God. Volume 17, 3825. Now, if you, Louisa, want to cover the paths of the eternal will, enter through the door of my humanity. In it you will find my divinity. The divine will shall make present to you through, as though in act, all that it did and does and will do, both in creation and redemption and in sanctification. You will have the contentment of being able to kiss those acts and to place in each one of them your little act of love, of adoration, of gratitude. There you will find my acts, all of them, in the act of giving themselves to you, and you will love them and will take the gifts of your celestial Father. Greater than these he could not give you, the gifts, the fruits, the effects of his divine will. But you will take them according to how much you cooperate, letting your human will live as dissolved with mine. So here again is our Lord showing Louisa that both in creation, redemption, and sanctification, to give the kiss, our kiss with Louisa in each one of our acts of love so that the kingdom can be established. And our job is to embolden, make more powerful all the acts that have occurred. Jesus and Mary and Louisa have done everything. And when we link ourselves to Louisa, we can also repair and redo. Like he says, you will love these acts and give these gifts to your Heavenly Father. We can give back to God the blessings that God has given to us. But you will take them according to how much you cooperate, letting your human will live as dissolved within God's holy divine will. So here, it's the whole prayer to the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful Catholics and kindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit and we shall be recreated and you will renew the face of the earth through us. Everything needs to be repaired. Everything needs to be redone in the divine will. And Jesus has done this, and Mary has done this, and now they've given it to Louisa, and offering this to us as well, so that we can repair and redo. Giving our kiss of love to every act that has occurred in creation, redemption, and now sanctification. Jesus tells Louisa in Volume 17, 6325, that Louisa says, I was fusing myself in the holy divine will and according to my usual way, and I was thinking to myself, where has our Lord done more for the creature, in creation, in redemption, or in sanctification? And my always adorable Jesus, moving in my interior, showed me all of creation, what sublimeness, what magnificence, how many harmonies, what order. There is not one point, either in heaven or on earth, in which God has not created something special and distinct. And with such mastery, that before the tiniest thing created by God, the greatest scientists feel that all of their science and mastery is absolutely nothing compared to the things created by God, which are full of life and of motion. Oh, how true it is that to look at the universe and not to recognize God, to love God and to believe in God is true madness. All created things are like many veils which hide him, and God comes to us as though veiled in each created thing. Because man is incapable of seeing God unveiled in his mortal flesh. The love of God for us is so great that in order to dazzle us with his light, frighten us with his power. He makes us feel ashamed in front of his beauty. He makes us annihilated before his immensity. He veils himself in created things so as to come be and be with us in each created thing, even more to make us swim in his very life. Oh my God, how much you love us. How much do you do love us? So here, Louisa says that in everything created, I mean, look at the little ant on the ground and look at the great tree in the forest. Look at the stars in the sky. Everything shows how great our God is. And that's what St. Thomas Aquinas tells us. We see the love of God in all created things. And now our God is asking us, pleading with us, to allow him, to allow us to cooperate with him in all created things. To give back to God, and I love you, for everything that he's created. To give back to God, I praise you, and I adore you, and I worship you, and I glorify you in all that is around us. How great creation is. Yet, Jesus says that every animal, vegetable, mineral, every blade of grass, grain of sand, a drop of water, everything is an I love you. And he is expecting us to be the reciprocal I love you back to him. How glorious this is. Then, after he made me look at the universe, my sweet Jesus told me, my daughter Louisa, everything was made in creation. It is in the divine will. The divine divinity manifested all of its majesty, power, and wisdom, and displayed its complete love towards souls. There is not one point, either in heaven, on earth, or in all created things, in which the perfection of our works is not complete. Not one thing was left half-made. In creation, God showed off all of his works for his creatures. He loved with a complete love and made complete works. There was nothing to be added or nothing to be removed. So when I, Jesus, made everything, I made it perfect. Nor can we, triune God, do incomplete works. On the contrary, in creating things, we, triune God, placed a distinct and complete love in creation for each creature. The redemption, then, was a redemption of the evils that the creatures had done. In adding nothing, it added nothing to the work of creation. And sanctification is nothing other than the help, the grace, the light, so that man may return to his original state of creation, to his origin, to the purpose for which he was created. Now, this is so great. Redemption was reparation for the evils that we have done. It added nothing to the work of creation. Nothing to the work of sanctification. And sanctification is nothing other than the grace, the light, that the soul may return to its original state, to go back to the Garden of Eden, to his original purpose and place for which he was created. See, we're here on earth because of Adam's sin. Everything around us reflects the beauty of God, yet in the Garden of Eden, in paradise, in heaven, it is more beautiful than earth. There's more colors, there's more light, there's more love, there's more life in all that is around us in when we go to Eden. Jesus says, in fact, in creation, by virtue of my divine will, the sanctity of man was complete. Since he came out from a complete act of God, he was the man holy and happy in the soul because my divine will brought to him the reflections of the sanctity of his creator, just as he was happy and holy in the body. So here, we're going to receive that again. And it's unfortunate that today we become old, gray-haired, wrinkled, and die. This was never part of God's plan. We were supposed to be eternally young with God. And when we go back to the garden, and some people who have died and come back to life, you know, had a close encounter with heaven. You hear what they say. It's true. Everyone is young. Everyone is happy. Everyone is beautiful. And this is the life that our God wants for us. Unfortunately, because of Adam's sin, we are here. Yet, not to get discouraged, our job is to obtain a high place in heaven. By being faithful and obedient to Christ and his church, to struggle and strive for perfection. Jesus says, you must be perfect as my heavenly Father is perfected. And now he has given us this gift of the divine will to to repair and redo in the name of everyone and everything, past, present, and future. How glorious this is. Everything is going to be redone in God's holy divine will through the souls that are linked to Louisa. So this is why it is the greatest gift. It is the most magnificent gift that God has given to the earth. My daughter Louisa, with all redemption in the work of sanctification, sanctity in man is incomplete. For others, it is almost useless. Now I say this, if a man does not turn back in order to take my divine will as life, as rule, as food, to be purified, ennobled, and divinized, to place himself in the prime act of creation, and take my divine will as his inheritance, assigned to him by God, the very work of redemption and sanctification will not have their abundant effects. So you see what God is asking of us. We have to turn back to take this divine will as our life. Now, for the last 2,000 years, we followed the saints, their humanity, and it is not divine. It is doing the will of God, but not living in the will of God. There's a vast difference, and now Jesus is asking us that we are the ones, as the church tells us, that we are in the final days, to begin to live this abundant life. Take the divine will as life. Take the divine will as rule. Take the divine will as food. I have a food that you do not know of, Jesus says. Take the divine will in order to be purified, to be ennobled, to be divinized, and to place ourselves in the prime act of creation. To take the divine will as our and divine inheritance, assigned by God. So when we do this, the works of redemption and of sanctification will have their abundant effects. God has great plans, and he needs us to cooperate, because he can't find anybody else. I was reading something on a blog on the internet the other day of something Catholic, and the viciousness and the vileness and the hatred and the demonic that was responding to something that was beautiful and holy was shocking. When Our Lady tells us that we're far worse than we were at the time of Noah, I truly believe it. People do not want God. They do not love the things of God. They don't. They're filled with hate and violence. Our job is to repair. To repair and redo in the name of everyone and everything. And what Our Lady tells Father Gobi is that means we go to Calvary. It means that we surrender totally to the Lord so that the kingdom can be established. It's not what it was a few years ago. And when you read that the gates of hell have been opened, I do believe that that is true. Yet God is going to win. God is victorious. We sing the victory song of Jesus. We go to Calvary with Our Lady. We see Jesus crucified. Again, it's very important that we begin to live this life of the divine will. And again, the consequence of the divine will are peace, joy, and happiness amid all the violence, amid all the hatred. There is that peaceful, joyful, happy life of heaven reigning in us. And when everybody else is falling away, when our families, our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, our parishioners are turning their backs to Jesus and his church, our job is to repair and redo in the name of everyone and everything, past, present, and future. So Jesus says, it is one single point which embraces and encloses the goods of redemption and of sanctification. Even more, for one who lives in my divine will, after he has taken the prime point of creation, all these goods serve not as remedy for those who do not do my divine will, but also as glory and a special inheritance carried upon the earth by the divine will of the celestial Father in the person of the Word, Jesus. So here, we see God has created, Christ has redeemed, and now sanctification is taking place. And he's using us to accomplish what he, God, is going to do. And that's why the surrender, to the docility, the submission is so necessary. And if I, Jesus, came upon earth, it was exactly the prime act to make known the divine will of my Father in order to bind it again to souls. The pains, the humiliations of my hidden life and of all the immense sea and pains of my passion were remedies, were medicines, supports, where they were lights in order to make my divine will known. Because with the divine will, I, Jesus, would make man not only be saved, but holy. See, that's what God is calling us to. This holiness, the sharing in divinity is what the Lord wants us to possess. Again, it's not just to be good. It's not just to be happy. It's to share in divinity. This is why God has created us. That's why you have to remember that drop of water put into the chalice filled with wine. We represent that drop of water, that drop of nothing. Entering into that wine, the drop of water becomes wine. And then the prayer is, may we share in the divinity of Christ as Christ humbled himself to share in our humanity. Jesus says very clearly, he says, with my pains I have placed man in safety. With my divine will I give him back the sanctity lost in the terrestrial Eden. So we have been saved. Okay, Jesus has pulled us from the well. And now we were broken and bleeding. Now God wants to heal us so that we're no longer broken and bleeding. He has saved us. He has redeemed us. And now he wants to sanctify us. He says very, very clearly, he says, with my divine will, I will give back to mankind the sanctity that they lost in the terrestrial Eden. And then Jesus said, had I not done this, my love, my work would not have been complete as they were in creation, because my divine will alone has the virtue of rendering complete our works toward the souls and the work of creatures towards us. My divine will makes one think in a way which is different from the human way. Okay, again, it's not to think things through humanly. It's now to think with the mind of Christ, to think things divinely. And that's what Jesus teaches us through the book of heaven. As you read, as you study, as you put this into practice, you no longer are thinking in a human, from a human perspective. You're thinking from a divine perspective. So God wants to restore us. God wants to renew us and recreate us. And this is what the divine will is all about. So he says very clearly, had I not done this, my love, my work would not have been complete as they were in creation, because my divine will alone has the virtue of rendering complete our work towards souls and the work of souls towards us. My divine will makes one think in a way which is different from the human way. It makes one look at my divine will in all created things, speak with the echo of my divine will, work through the veils of my divine will. In a word, one does everything all at once, according to my supreme volition, which leads the soul rapidly to perfect sanctity. So it's not to do, see the saints, I love the saints, but Jesus says the saints are like stars at night, twinkling in the night. Louisa, you and those linked to you, Louisa, will be a sun at high noon, giving light and life to everyone and everything, which eclipses the stars, eclipses the saints. So Jesus has saved the best for last, and he's asking us to participate with him. While the other virtues act slowly, little by little, but my redemption itself, without the prime act of my divine will, serves as a dressing of the deepest wounds, as the medicine for man to not let him die, as the antidote to not let him fall into hell. So the redemption has the prime act of the divine will, and this is why Jesus has given us this gift. Therefore, to take to heart my divine will alone, you will really want to love me and to make yourself a saint. So if we want the divine will to reign in us, Jesus says, we will really fall more and more in love with Jesus and Mary. And that's what happens. You fall in more in love with the church. You listen to the Holy Father. You read your breviary. You read sacred scripture. You read the dogma and doctrine, and it becomes alive. You see the truths that are there. And why? Because we're taking to heart the divine will, and we're falling more in love with Jesus and Mary, and even Louisa, the little daughter, and we are making ourselves a saint. So volume 19, 6:20-26. Okay. So it is my divine will alone that brings all fullness of my goods and to complete fruit contained in creation, redemption, and sanctification. So as Jesus says, be fruitful and multiply, he is now showing us that this is what happens in the divine will alone. Okay, whoever reigns, wherever the divine will reigns, our works are full of life. Nothing is halved or incomplete. While where it does not reign, even if some virtues were present, everything is misery, everything is incomplete, and if they produce any fruit at all, it is unripe without maturity. So what Jesus is showing us is this is why we have to go to confession each week. This is why communities fall apart. This is why we're only 1 billion people are living as Catholics. And out of that 1 billion, how many are really being faithful and obedient to the Catholic faith? Because he says the divine will is not there completely. It doesn't reign. And this is what he's looking for. He's looking for the divine will to reign. So the new evangelization that the church is talking about is this gift of the divine will. Because this will bring fruit to such an extent that everyone will be Catholic. Every Jew, every Buddhist, every Hindu, every Muslim, every Protestant will become Catholic. Why? Because that was the universal life that Adam had before the fall. And God wants to now restore mankind to this universal life. So he says, and if they take the fruits of my redemption, they take them with measure and without abundance, and therefore they grow as weak, sick, and feverish. And if they do a little bit of good, they do it strained. If they feel crushed, and they feel the crushed under the weight of the bit of good that they do. And again, that's where we are at this point. God wants to change that. On the other hand, my divine will empties the human will, and in that void it places the divine strength and the life of good. Therefore, one who lets the divine will reign within themselves does good without strain. And the life that the soul contains leads her to operate good with an irresistible strength. So my humanity found life in my passion and my death in order, and those to whom the divine will would reign. So my humanity found life in my passion and death, and in those in whom my divine will would reign. Hopefully that's us. Therefore, creation redemption will always be incomplete until my divine will has its kingdom in souls. That's what Jesus is looking for in us. He wants to see the divine will reigning in us. He needs to see the divine will reigning in us. This is how much our God loves us. After this, I was doing my usual act in the supreme volition, my sweet Jesus coming out from my interior, followed everything I did with his gaze. Okay, so Jesus is very focused on what we're doing. And since he saw that all my acts identified with his and by virtue of the supreme will, they followed the same course as his acts and repeated the same good and the same glory for our celestial Father. Taking the emphasis of love, he clasped me to his sacred heart and told me, my daughter, Louisa, even though you are little and newly born in my divine will and you live in the kingdom of my divine will, your littleness is my triumph. See, this is the Eucharistic reign of Jesus. We become living hosts. He reigns in us. It is the triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. We become like her son. This is her triumph. So when I, Jesus, see you operate in the divine will, I myself find the kingdom of my divine will, like a king who has fought a long war. And since this ideal was victory, and seeing himself victorious, he feels cheered of the bloody battle, and from the hardship suffered, and from the wounds still impressed on his person, and his triumph formed as he sees himself surrounded and by the conquests he has made. The king wants to look at everything. His gaze wants to delight in the kingdom conquered and triumphant as he smiles and makes feast. So here Jesus says, again, this is why it's so beautiful, and so I am. See, Jesus says his name. My ideal in creation was the kingdom of my divine will in the soul of Adam. My primary purpose was to make Adam the image of the divine Trinity by virtue of the fulfillment of my divine will upon him. But as Adam withdrew from my divine will, I lost my kingdom in Adam. And as for 6,000 years, I had to sustain the long battle. But long as it has been, I have not dismissed my ideal and the primary purpose for which I created Adam. Nor will I dismiss it. And if I, Jesus, came in redemption, I came to realize my ideal and my primary purpose, that is the kingdom of divine will in all souls, in all the children of Adam. This is so true that in order to come, I, Jesus, form my first kingdom of the supreme volition in the heart of my Immaculate Mama. Outside of my kingdom, I would never have come upon earth. Then I suffered hardships and pains, I was wounded, and I was killed at last, but the kingdom of my divine will was not realized. I, Jesus, laid the foundations and have made some preparations, but the bloody battle between the human will and the divine will has yet continued. So he says very clearly, he's so happy when he looks at Louisa. And are we happy when we look at Louisa? Jesus says this. He says, Louisa, he says, even though you are little and newly born, in my divine will, you live in the kingdom of my divine will. That's where we want to live. So that's why we want to be linked to Louisa. Even though you are little and newborn in my divine will, you live in the kingdom of my divine will, and your littleness is my triumph. When I see you operate in the divine will, I find myself in the kingdom of my divine will. Okay, so again, we want to please Jesus. We want to make God happy. So what do? We have been given, by the grace of God, the Book of Heaven. We read it, we study it, we put it into practice. Jesus says there are many books, but the only book that will transform a soul is the Book of Heaven. Our job is to link ourselves with Louisa. Our job is to live in the divine will. Again, fully that can't be accomplished at this point. God is looking at the desires. He says, when I see a soul who desires this more than anything else, I will give it to them. Okay, this is what God is looking for in us. The Holy Father will be the first to embrace this, and then all the world. And as he says in the last chapter of Volume 24, every Jew, Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim, Protestant will become Catholic. They will be restored with that universal life that Adam lost, that Catholic life. And see, we have to learn because we have fallen from such a height. Yet soon, when the kingdom is established, when the Holy Father embraces Louisa, the whole world will be transformed, transmuted. This is what Jesus promises. This is what Jesus is going to do. So he says very clearly, now, my little daughter, when I, Jesus, see you operate in the kingdom of my divine will, and as you, Louisa, operate, its kingdom is established more and more in you, I feel victorious in my long battle, and everything around me makes an attitude of triumph and feast. My pains and the hardships and the wounds smile at me. My very death gives me back the life of my divine will in you, Louisa. And those souls linked to Louisa, hopefully that's us. So I, Jesus, feel victorious in creation and redemption. Even more, they serve to form the long rounds for the newborn of my divine will. See, okay, so he's showing us how to pray the round of creation, round of redemption. Her rapid flights, this is what the divine will, this is what the rounds are about. Her endless strolls, again, this is what the rounds are about. In the kingdom of my divine will, give God such happiness. And so I, Jesus, boast in the triumph. I, Jesus, boast and the delighting, and I follow with my gaze all the steps and all the acts of my little daughter, Luisa Picaretta, and the souls linked to Luisa. This is what God is looking for. Are we linked to Luisa? How do you become linked to Luisa? By reading and studying and putting into practice the truths that Jesus has dictated to her. She's the little secretary. When you read the volumes, you're listening to Jesus Christ. He is touching your soul. If you are docile, if you're submissive, if you are surrendered to the Lord, how much He will transform you. He will transmute you. And He will use you in a way that all the saints are longing for us to do. And if they were here on earth, they would fight to possess this, because they see how great this great gift of the divine will is. But no, God has given it to us. God is expecting us to really begin to be linked to Luisa by reading, studying, and putting into practice these truths. So we'll end there in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Dearest Lord Jesus, I thank you for your lessons of today. Free me from living one single instant outside of your will. Have pity on me and do not permit that I either know or acquire any other life except that of your divine will. Fiat et amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.